better than nothing.
Welcome to Squat Cobbler. We're doing another one of our album exchanges. Let's do the introductions first. I'm Mike at Official Pagan, and joining me always...
Hi, everybody. This is Kelly at K-E-L-L-Y-T-H-U-L on Twitter.
All right, everybody. So we're going to do something a little bit different now. So all you guys loved our Alice Cooper review. So Kelly came up with this awesome idea of doing these album prisoner exchanges where we each introduce the other one to an album that we love that we think the other one's not super familiar with. And then we review it the same way we did the Alice Cooper records. Well, one of the things that we had in the back of our minds as we started this process is taking some requests and letting you guys and people we know suggest albums to us. And of course, who better to kind of kick that off than Mel? Kelly and I have both known Mel for a long time. Kelly does Nurture and Support, which this is sort of a spinoff of with Mel. And how many years have you guys been doing Nurture and Support now?
Since 2013.
So 2013. That's a long time.
I guess we'll be hitting a 5-year anniversary here in October or so.
Wow. See, I'm not good at math, so I'm going to take your word for that. But Kelly says that that's 5 years, so I'm going to roll with it. I know Mel, of course, from Snark Alec Radio, going back to when we were doing the Loud and Loaded radio station and stuff like that. And then she left that, and her and Kelly have been doing this ever since. And I'm a huge, huge fan of Nurture and Support, as all you guys know. Even though I'm not able to listen to the most recent episode because I'm not caught up on Westworld, and I saw it was Westworld related.
Gonna be a few of those coming up, so
I'm gonna lodge an official complaint right now. You guys have to do 2 episodes then, so that I can still get an episode until I catch up. Mel is a good friend of ours, and so something that I've kind of thought was interesting going into this, having Mel choose the first outside suggestion or request for a prisoner exchange was obviously a perfect fit for this. One of the things, though, and Kelly's perspective on this might be a little bit different than mine. Everybody knows that Mel loves cello music. Beyond that, though, to be honest with you, I don't know a lot about Mel's musical taste. The only time we've discussed it a little bit was actually an episode of Nurture and Support that I was a guest on. And I had a recommendation specifically for Mel to check out my friends in Psychotica because of Enrique's cello playing. I thought she might enjoy their stuff. Beyond that, though, and a little bit of music talk during that, I'm not really familiar prior to going into this with what Mel's musical tastes are. What about you, Kelly?
I've gotten glimmers as we've kind of talked through. Typically on Nurture and Support, there's not been a ton of music that's not cello related that Mel's recommended, but there's been some. But I did have a sense that it was diverse. It was sorely lacking Alice Cooper experience, which we helped with our reviews. I knew there was a warm spot in her heart for angsty kind of emo stuff. And so I know she liked some of that. But the list that she provided, which was significant in terms of things to choose from, there were a lot of surprises on there for me.
Yeah. And just to explain to everybody, the way that this ended up happening was Kelly pitched this idea to Mel, and she provided us with a whole list of albums to choose from. And when I got the list, I have to be honest, I was pretty surprised by it. Not that I had any particular expectations going in, because as I said, I really don't know what kind of stuff beyond cellos Mel is into. But there was way more crossover from my tastes on that list than I would have imagined. If we were going into this, if you were going to say Mel's going to give us a list of, I don't remember what it was off the top of my head, so I'm going to say 20 albums, I would not have thought that 15 of those 20 albums are albums I also own already. Never would have imagined that going into it.
Yeah, I wouldn't have either. Although you have a large collection, so I guess it's not entirely surprising. You've listened to a wide variety of things. I did not have a lot of common ground with Mel on her list.
That's interesting. See, I would have thought, again, having no knowledge going into this, I would have guessed you and Mel would have a lot of crossover. Maybe I would have heard of a list of 20, I would have vaguely heard of 3 of those acts. But instead, I knew most of it, and apparently you didn't have a lot of crossover. But what we did, just to kind of keep everybody on top of this, Kelly and I decided to go with an album that neither of us was familiar with.
Yes, indeed. Grantley Buffalo, which I'm surprised to find out upon initial research is not a Civil War general or a buffalo.
And what's interesting, so not only was I surprised by the list, I was surprised by how much crossover there is. I'm surprised that you didn't have a lot of crossover with Mel. I had no idea what the hell this was going into it. Like, none. This isn't just an album I didn't listen to. This is at first glance at the list, something I never heard of, which I'm glad, because I'm glad we can kind of go into the first one. I hope that's at least some of these recommendations are sort of clean slate things for us, where we can go into it with a total open mind, give our honest opinions on it, and hopefully be exposed to something that we're both into that we weren't familiar with before. And I'm also glad, because there's one album on Mel's list that it's just a band. I've never listened to the album, but I hate that band. So I'm so glad that we didn't choose that. I'm not even going to say what it is. I'm so glad that we didn't choose that one. And also got the opportunity to go clean slate on something
in our usual fashion. I'm not sure how many minutes we're into the show now, but we're quite a bit into the show yet. We've not started the review, which is, I found on past Alice Cooper reviews, people love that. They love it when
they do. This is their favorite.
Because we said Grantley Buffalo, but we haven't even mentioned the album is Mighty Joe Moon.
Whoa, slow down there, Ace. I don't know why you have to rush through this thing.
I know. I'm just trying to.
Also, it was really fun to call you Ace. I'm going to start calling you Sport and things Sport. Like that.
Yeah, that's awesome. looking forward to that.
All right, Sonny. So, as Kelly already gave away the big twist of the album title.
The twist? That's the twist of this review, which will be the title of this.
I thought we could get like 45 minutes into this before we actually talked about the album. So I guess we should just jump into the first song. Before we say that, though, there's one caveat that I hope you guys always understand going into this. This is Kelly and I's opinion of an album. You guys aren't necessarily going to share our opinions. We aren't even necessarily going to share each other's opinions. But one thing I can assure you is we know better than you do. So with that said, we're going to go into the first song. Now, I don't know about you, Kelly, but I opted to not do any research prior to going into this. I just went in total blank slate, had no idea what this was going to sound like. And based off the rest of Mel's list, this is not at all what I thought this was going to sound like. So the first song is Lone Star Song. My initial impression of this is that it's sort of like a country grunge song, if that makes sense to you. There is one thing about this song before I kick it over to you to say some things about it. I'm going to use this song to bring up, and I'm only going to do it once because it's throughout the entire album. This is not a complaint. It's not a quibble. I'm not nitpicking. It's just a observation. There's some really interesting enunciation and phrasing of the lyrics in here. The actual lyrical phrasing, the way the words are set up throughout the song, is a little bit different than what you would expect from a typical like mainstream radio type of song. And some of the enunciation, which I would guess is a regional thing, is a little bit weird, the way that he enunciates certain words. And it was interesting. It's not a complaint, but it's something that in this song right off the bat kind of grabbed me. So the song is called Lone Star Song, and he really enunciates the R's at the end of star. This seems weird, I know, but follow me with this. If you listen to most any type of music, listen when they say a word like star, especially if it's in the chorus where they're dragging the word out a little bit, they kind of taper off at the end. Whereas Grantley Phillips, the vocalist of this band, over enunciates the R at the end of it, which I have to assume has to do with his own regional dialect. Beyond that, it's I know this is weird. Beyond that, though, it's a really cool song. It was a really great way to kick off the album. And if you're going to kick off a country grunge song, it probably should be about Waco.
Yeah, that was a nice touch, I thought. So I did not do any research prior to listening either. So basically, my expectations were set by the name of the band, the name of the album, and the cover art, and the origin of the recommendation. So I had kind of triangulated that into saying, I have an idea what this is going to sound like. And this first song, I was like, hey, so I was completely wrong on what this is going to sound like. I had country rock, southern rock as a note as well. Very kind of some soaring guitars. It's interesting on the enunciation point you make, because the vocal delivery, and it's really only on this song, it felt to me like a kinder, gentler Tony Okay in terms of a little bit of lyrical content and delivery on it, which is kind of a big hit for me because I'm a big Tonio fan. And throughout this album, some pretty clever lyrics going on. Waco's subject matter here and includes the line, they had him nailed up to a T with a T for Texas. A unique little lyrical line. Pretty cool. I thought a really good start to this album. I like this song quite a bit. It's not an affected delivery, but the guy's got a unique delivery style. And to me, he sounded a little bit like a kinder, gentler Tony O'Kay on this first song.
I can see that, especially with some of the, like you said, the lyrical content really paints that picture a little bit more. And I'm not surprised that you enjoyed this song. For any of you who don't know, Kelly has a musical background himself and has an unreleased rock opera about the Ruby Ridge incident.
Yeah, something like that. It's the Newt Rockne story. No, yeah. So I'm gonna move us on to song number two, which is Mockingbird.
How long technically have we spent now just getting this song number two?
A long time. I'm sure our listeners will give us some feedback on exactly how long it took us. But Mockingbirds is the second track with the strong lyrics. Devastation at last, we finally meet. Tattoo material, in my opinion.
Absolutely.
It's odd how on most some of these Prisoner Exchange albums, I'm finding a lot more tattoo material than I did with Alice, which is concerning to me. We'll see how it goes. Song number two, not in the ballpark I thought it would be. This shifts from more of that country rock of southern rock of Lone Star Song, and it's kind of, you've got a little bit of Beatlesque stuff going on here. You got a little bit of Kinks in terms of it, or maybe a little bit of XTC trying to sound like the Beatles. So there, and there's some complex tempo changes in there, or varied tempo changes in it as well. But I thought that it was a strong second track. What were your thoughts?
So whereas the first song, the enunciation thing was something that stuck out to me. He, on the more country or southern sort of segments or segues in that first song, he hits that old school country lilt really well with his voice. On this song, it's an abrupt change right away. Because I thought, all right, first song, kind of a grungy rock sound with a lot of country and southern rock influences. Kind of thought that was going to set the tempo for the album. My first note on this song is Hillbilly Grace. So for anyone, if you're familiar with the Jeff Buckley album Grace, this almost sounds like something that could be off of that, but with more of that country sort of feel to it.
Yeah, Hillbilly Grace was my favorite wrestler in the mid-80s, too. So
I'm going to keep that theme going. So if you're upset, listeners, that I called them hillbillies, you're about to get a lot more upset.
Oh, boy. Awesome. This is going well.
You're welcome in advance. So track number three, unless you had anything else to add to Mockingbirds.
Nope. Although two songs down, two good songs.
Absolutely. Track number three. It's the Life. My first note on this, Hillbilly Celtic. This has the feel in a lot of ways of like a Celtic style folk song. However, another thing that I wrote down next to it, this, by the way, to me is the weakest point of the album. And it's because of the arrangement of the song itself. I wrote achy breaky heart arrangement next to it. So I was reading an article recently. I'm going to go off on a tangent because people love that. I was reading an article recently about why we hate certain songs, even songs that were catchy and did well at one point. And they used Achy Breaky Heart from Billy Ray Cyrus, or as our younger listeners would know, Miley Cyrus's dad. As an example, that song was a really big hit because it came out around the time that line dancing became particularly popular across the U.S., not just in more southern and rural areas, but the song itself is one chord repeated over and over, and it never changes at all. There are no changes. It is the same chord from verse to chorus, no change in tempo, no change in his vocal delivery throughout the entire song. The same thing happens on this song. So to me, this is the weak spot of the album, just because musically it is very repetitive and there is no change, no diversity to this song. This is the one song I didn't like on this record. What about you, sir?
So I'm sorry I don't have a hillbilly modifier to go with. Okay. I did in my notes, I did have folky. So I felt this definitely had that kind of folk music going on, kind of feel to it. And this actually was the sound that I was kind of expecting. So the first two songs were different, and I was like, okay, so this is kind of sort of what I thought it might sound like. I would agree that on a relative sense, There's a lot stronger stuff on this album than this one. It is probably, because I just kind of try and rank the songs to remind myself as I go back through which were the ones that I really like the best and how they do relatively. And this one is in a lower register on the album itself. It was the sound that I had kind of expected. It wasn't to me as kind of creative or intriguing as first two. I did not mind the song, but I said there's stronger stuff on either side of it.
Absolutely. And if you want, you could call it hillbilly folk, but that seems redundant.
We're losing hillbilly followers in droves, Mike. It's on you.
Come back. Don't worry.
Okay. I'm sure it's everything. It's all uphill from here.
It's all uphill for the hillbillies.
Great. We'll move on to song number four, which is Sing Along. This has plenty of tempo changes going on to it. Hallelujah Hoodwink as a lyric, which is pretty awesome. A John Wayne Gacy reference, which I'm sure I'll hear more from Mike about. Some jangly guitars, and again, some pretty cool lyrics where it's, I'll build you a river, but I'm not through with this arc, which I think is pretty amazing.
Yeah, I really like, there's a lot of great lyrical pulls from this one. John Wayne Gacy, like Kelly said, I think we can all say that John Wayne Gacy is our favorite serial killer clown, right? Can we make that blanket statement for the show?
He's the I think the official serial killer clown of Squat Cobbler.
Official serial killer clown of Squat Cobbler is John Wayne Gacy's Pogo. So I realized something when this song came about, which is the stuff I like the best. Other than the previous song, there's no other sort of dislikes. And honestly, it's just the song didn't go anywhere musically. There's no other like dislikes though. And even that's, I wouldn't really call it a dislike, but this song made me realize when I really know I'm going to like a song on this record, there's kind of a tell, which is the bass is a lot more prominent in the mix. All of the songs that I really, really like and all of the standouts. So as Kelly mentioned, sort of ranking the songs, if I was ranking the songs in the top echelon of this album, are all the songs where the bass is prominent in the mix. This is one of those songs.
Yeah. And again, not a sound I anticipated, and a lot of variety in this song. So a good one.
So that brings us to the title track, Mighty Joe Moon. We're back to a little bit of the softer kind of thing with this, but unlike our Hillbilly Celtic song that came earlier, I feel like there's a lot more going on in this song comparatively. It's still a simple song pared back compared to what we just heard on Sing Along or what you heard on Lone Star Song, but there's just a lot more going on with it than you had with the Hillbilly Celtic song. What about you, sir?
It is. So title track. Leaner than some of the other stuff. It kind of lopes along. Maybe hillbilly emo would be.
Go with that. See, now you're getting in on the fun.
Yeah, that's great. And it has a Cumberland Gap reference. And what song? How can a song not be awesome with a Cumberland Gap reference? Kind of music gold. That's pretty cool. Yeah, so I enjoyed it. It is in the softer register, solid, diverse. I said a good song. I don't think the standout of this album. And so I don't know how you go through the process of picking what's the title track, but I say this is very, very solid, but I almost expected a Mighty Joe Moon to be a bit more of an opus given the fact that it was the title of the album as well, but it was very good. I liked it
again. And this is going to seem weird and nitpicky. I 100% agree with Kelly. As a title track, I probably would have gone with one of the stronger sounding songs like Lone Star Song or Sing Along that just has a lot more going on with it. Because I feel like, especially in Lone Star Song up until this point, you've kind of heard all of the elements put together. You heard the more rock oriented, the alternative grunge sort of influence. You heard the folky southern roots of it, along with that sort of country lilt on the vocals. So personally, I probably would have called this Lone Star Song. Plus, it's about Waco. And Kelly is a huge fan of standing your ground against the government.
And YouTube.
Standing your ground against me?
No, not you. YouTube.
YouTube loves you.
Yeah, deeply.
By show of likes and dislikes, how many of you at this point in the review want to hear Kelly's rock opera about Ruby Ridge?
Yeah, well, in the comments, just let us know. It does open up with the rollicking number Gun Rack, but we'll talk more about that later.
by the end of this, we're going to really write this album. We'll have song titles and
it'll all be set. Maybe we can get back to Mighty Joe Moon. And the next song is Demon Called Deception. Another candidate for me for album title, because it is a great song title and a good song. You had mentioned prior to us getting together that in your notes, there were a couple of odd comments, and you were kind of saying, let me go back and refresh myself and see what's there. So that happened to me too on my notes, because my main note on Demon Called Deception is if the song Mighty Joe Moon was a mean drunk, it would sound like Demon Called Deception. So I'm not entirely sure what I meant by that. But
you know what's funny though is I feel like I get that.
Yeah, because it's not derivative of my Mighty Joe Moon, but it is, if it's surlier, it's got more edge to it, but some of the bones are similar. So this is a very enjoyable song. I'm in tight with a Demon Called Deception tattoo material yet again. So good stuff. I really was impressed with the lyrics on a lot of this album.
Kelly is going to look like a fresh out of jail gang member.
That's right.
By the time we get a few more albums into this thing. I really enjoyed this song. Great title, like you said. Your observation of it actually makes sense if you listen to the album. And I assume if you guys are listening to this, you're going to check out the album with us. And you're going to form your opinions, which, unless they're the same as ours, are completely wrong. But I knew right from the start, again, this is the giveaway for me. Bass is really prominent in the mix. I knew I was going to like this song.
Yeah, that fits the bill for sure.
Which is weird. I don't know why it's like that, but I accept it. As soon as I hear the bass prominent in the song, I know this is going to be one of those top tier songs for me. So that brings us to our next song, Lady Godiva and Me. So if anyone doesn't know, Kelly has a naked horse riding story that he's going to tell us right now. Kelly?
Incorrect. Fake news. Back to you, Mike.
This song, so on the softer tracks on this album, and especially on the Celtic Hillbilly track, I felt like they were building towards something that they never got to. And this song is 100% like the release of that, because you start off softer. This actually builds up into a fuller, more rock oriented track. So you finally get the build up on this song that I felt like we were promised on two other tracks at this point that didn't quite get there.
Yeah, I'd agree. I think, you know, in some ways this, they kind of go cheap on us here, because just kind of like, you know, where a comedian will do their go-tos around, oh, people are mean at the DMV, or don't you hate waiting in long lines at Disney World? You know, who doesn't have a Minotaur mask? And so for them to call out early Minotaur mask, you know, it's just, that's playing to the crowd. Everybody, you know, they're going to immediately identify with that. But so that jumped out at me quite a bit. It lopes along, again, a slower tempo, pretty cool, interesting song. And then what kind of brightened my day in particular for the song is you get about 70% through it. It's a great song, clever lyrics again, great sound. And then the Who stops by and plays guitar for a couple minutes and then leaves, which is, there is just some serious Who guitar at the tail end of this that, being a big Who fan, I welcome. And I thought it was well executed. And so it was nice to have, and again, unexpected on this album to have a little drive-by by the Who.
Yeah. And that's part of that buildup that I talked about on this track. And again, you know, maybe you guys can expect some Who guitars on Kelly's magnum opus that he's working on.
What opus is there without a brief interlude of Who guitars?
True.
Or Who guitar, I guess.
I believe that's a Trump quote directly.
Yeah. But it was awesome. So that goes into, now this actually is my favorite song on the album, Drag, Slide Guitar. Some pretty nice little guitar break in the middle. Lyrically, some awesome stuff going on. Shoot that cannonball into my wings. Would you kiss of my eyes? Which I think is my new Twitter handle. But it's a really cool song. I can't entirely put my finger on. This is not a bass heavy song, so it's probably not high on your list. But there was just something of I enjoyed this album quite a bit. this was one I came back to quite a bit. This is my favorite song.
This is a really good song. It would definitely be in the upper echelon for me. There's a good amount of bass on this song, but in general, you kind of get everything that I like about this album. You get the strong Southern rock and country influences along with what was then sort of the modern rock, alternative and grunge elements to it here and there. You get everything that I like about this album on this track. So I think it's a great choice for favorite song for you or for any of our listeners who want to agree with us, because we're always right. And that brings us to the last days of what the
bad word
is. That word,
Tecumseh.
What is that?
That is an Indian chief.
I did not know that.
Native American chief.
So this is by far the shortest song on the album, and it is also a banjo and vocal track. Are you a fan of banjos before we get any further into this?
They're the poor man's cello, I guess. Banjo is the poor man's cello.
Ah, oh, so good.
In small doses, sure. And I think its involvement on this album is appropriately sized. I had this song. This was another one that I would have kind of said, this is my favorite song on the album, but it's like, wow, it's like gone almost immediately. Yeah. It's so short that I don't know if it could carry the flag of favorite song, but I like it. It was a departure. So I'm okay with banjo, but probably not banjo heavy. Where are you on the banjo continuum, Mike?
I'm very much pro banjo, and hearing this song kind of made me wish there was some banjo or more prominent banjo prior to this. I would have loved to hear some banjo on Lone Star Song or Demon Called Deception. I think it could have worked really well. I'm particularly, not only am I a fan of banjo, I'm a fan of putting banjo in songs where you wouldn't expect banjo to be and using it to accent songs. I think it's a really great instrument. So this kind of made me like, well, if they play banjo, why am I not getting more banjo?
In the Ruby Ridge musical Lawman. The song Lawman is heavily banjo influenced.
Can I play the banjo?
Absolutely.
Yes.
On a porch.
We're recorded outside on a porch in overalls. You won't be able to hear that I'm wearing overalls, but you'll know.
You'll know. So we'll go to the next song, which is Happiness. I'm assuming ironically titled, because my notes begin, doesn't seem happy. This is not an Up With People reject song. This is an ironic read on happiness or the quest for happiness. If you find it, share it with the rest of us kind of thing. And so allow me, Mike, to demonstrate when we're going to categorize something as like something, how you can not use the word hillbilly, for example, because I'm actually pretty pleased with this. I kind of captured this song in my mind as being broken Jim Croce. Somehow he hit just, given up that this is the kind of music he'd be writing.
No, this is, I agree with that. This made me think of, and I keep coming back to them on things you wouldn't think of. It's kind of made me think of the Beach Boys a little bit.
Yeah, I didn't think about them at all on this song, just so you know.
So I love the Beach Boys. So if there's any way that I can relate the Beach Boys to something, I'm going to do so. It reminded me of their more melancholic lyrics, but not set to that Baroque pop music. Yes, I worked the Beach Boys into another review. Yeah.
And Baroque pop music.
Like, pop music.
It's no You're broken welcome. Croce, but it's all right.
I want somebody to go back and make a list of how many times I've compared odd things to the Beach Boys.
Yeah, that should pretty much be your trademark from here on out. It's just kind of work that into anything, a recommendation or a review.
Mike's going to talk about the Beach Boys now. Well, that brings us into the next song, Honey Don't Think. Ironically, this is the only song I don't have notes for.
So apparently you thought they were singing to you. So I have a few notes for you. It's the most pop song on this album, I'd say. Close. It's not pop rock per se, but it has more lilt to it than most of the rest of the stuff. It's a decent song. It does get into dark recesses here with lyrics along the lines of, could you learn to read minds? In the case of mine, can you read in the dark? Which sounds very depressing to me. I like the lyrics. I like the lyrics on this a lot.
You know, that line you just quoted reminds me of the Beach Boys a little bit. Let me tell you.
I don't know.
There's going to be a Beach Boys style harmony on the Ruby Ridge album.
Yeah, because it's a lyrical reimagining of In My Room, is kind of a end of the second act. We get that, so that's nice. Yeah, we are writing most of the Ruby Ridge,
but this is gonna be a real thing. Kelly Tool's Ruby Ridge, the musical. By the end of this, we'll be taking pre-orders.
we'll get the Kickstarter going to get the funding ready to roll. We'll move on to Side by Side, another. A favorite of mine on this album. There's an introductory guitar lick that occurs a couple times in this song, at the beginning, hence the introductory, at the beginning, but then a couple other times, that is highly reminiscent of another song. And I'm just wondering, did you pick up on that or not?
So it reminded me of something, but I couldn't put my finger on it.
Black Widow.
Okay.
So if you go back in the initial Black Widow by Alice Cooper, the kind of core framing guitar lick of Black Widow, a version of that. And it's kind of like the whole Vanilla Ice, dun, 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 dun. You know, it's like there's a little difference. So there's enough of a difference here that it's not a straight lift. And this is a 1994 release, and Black Widow is 75. So Alice wins on kind of doing the lick first, but highly reminiscent. I would say 80% is the same lick, but then it kind of cuts real quick into it. But it just caught me when I heard it, because I said, I've heard that before and I've always liked it.
I'm glad you knew what it was, because I've just been racking my brain as to which Beach Boys song.
Yeah, it's like, which one is it? Yeah, you can keep pondering that for a while, because it's Black Widow. So again, love the lyrics in this one. Got it, you know, and this is a lot about oppression and some things going on there, and this kind of just really clear and real, I gotta tell you, there's dissension in the soup lines kind of line is good stuff. I think one of the strongest offerings on the album.
Yeah, I really like this song as well. This is right up there with my favorites. Another thing too about this track, I have it written down, reminds me of something, dot, dot, dot. One of the things about this track though is there's a little bit of vocal departure on this too, where it's a little more straightforward, for lack of a better way to articulate it, sort of radio-esque singing, like a little more straightforward alternative rock singing on this one. Less of that sort of country southern rock lilt that we've heard up until this point. Not dramatically. It's not like he sounds like Kurt Cobain on this or anything, but there is a little bit of a difference.
I'd agree.
Which reminds me of the Beach Boys. All right, well, that brings us to the final track on the album, Rock of Ages. Did you think this was a cover?
I was wondering if it was going to be a cover. And I was going to be disappointed, because I wasn't really sure how a cover of that would have nestled in with the rest of the material here.
Yeah, I was super. So I pulled it up on my phone, glanced down the track list. I saw Rock of Ages, assumed it was a cover, started the album. And I was like, this is going to be weird when we get to this song. Not a cover. Not the Rock of Ages that you think it is. I like this song. I like the fade out in the end, particularly. The only thing where this song has a little bit of a weak spot for me, as Kelly mentioned, there are great, great lyrics on this record. There's a lot of great lines you could pull from for tattoos. Kelly basically is going to be a tattoo magazine model at this point. I feel like on an album that has such well thought out lyrics and great pull lines and stuff like that, this one was a little bit weaker in the lyrical department for me, but I still enjoyed the song.
Interesting. So this is of our many, many reviews. There's not been too many times where we've been like completely on opposite sides, but allow me to read you my first note on Rock of Ages.
Sure.
Best lyrics on an album of strong lyrics.
And I thought it was the weakest. I'm curious.
Throughout most of the rest of the album, these are the, you know, possibly least creative. I think they're the most clever. They're not as creative as some of the other ones, because they, you know, I reach for a rock in the avalanche is, you can tell they're trying there to go in. There's a little bit of that, but there's a bunch of it there. So I thought maybe they were the most clever. but not the most creative lyrics, because there's just some other stuff earlier that is just magic on there. But that's interesting that we would actually land very much on opposite sides on that. But I think what we can all agree on, thank God it wasn't a cover.
Yeah, that was, and maybe that's part of it too. Maybe I need to go back and re-listen to it. I think I was still just like, oh, thank God it's not that Rock of Ages.
Well, what we'll get a chance to do, what our hope is, and we'll see when we get this all packaged up, we want to give Mel a chance to listen to our musings on the album. And I guess I'll suggest, hey, you might want to go about 15, 20 minutes into the show.
When it starts,
we actually start to talk about the album. But she kind of knows what she's getting into there. But we,
does she, though?
I don't think she's going to have expected the prominence of Ruby Ridge, Hillbillies, and the Beach Boys in this review. But those are all little treasures for her to find.
There's slightly more Ruby Ridge talk than she may have expected.
Just want to warn you. You knew there'd be some. But we might have gone a little strong on Ruby Ridge this episode.
You can always expect some kind of Ruby Ridge reference. That's right. Anybody who's listening to this, go back. You will find hidden references to Ruby Ridge, the JFK assassination, and Flat Earth in most of our previous episodes.
And the Beach Boys.
Obviously the Beach Boys. I really do want a count of how many times I compare things to the Beach Boys.
It's building up. You added to the account significantly tonight, so congratulations.
Thank you.
But we hope to have Mel review our review, and we'll either append it to this audio, or we'll put it out as a little special edition. We'll see how the week works out and when we can get things done.
Can I throw something in there? Not only am I looking forward to hearing Mel's rebuttal of our review, and we both, I don't want to speak for you, but I think we both obviously really enjoyed this album. So hopefully there's not a whole lot of discrepancy there, but I would love to hear Mel's pick for a tattoo lyric on her. I would love to hear which song she thinks is most like the Beach Boys.
Of course.
And I think Mel should probably name a song on Ruby Ridge, the musical by Kelly Tool.
She'll get a chance to listen to this. She's an adult and will make her own decisions on what she will or won't. I have a hunch that some of your desires may not be met, you know, and so she's
definitely doing the Ruby Ridge one. I know it.
Yeah, we'll see. Looking forward to it. I declare this fun. I would recommend this album and I thank Mel for including it on her list, because I would never have come across this without her suggestion there. And I'm better for it. I actually did enjoy this quite a bit. It is very different than what I typically listen to, but I like it, and I'd recommend other people buy it and listen to it and enjoy it.
Absolutely. This is a great record. I really enjoyed it. There's one song I wasn't crazy about, but other than that, and it's more of a nitpicky music thing, I really enjoyed this album. I never would have found this on my own, never would have listened to it. I didn't know that this band existed. I thought going into this, I have since learned that I have heard songs by this band before, just nothing off of this album. A couple of their tracks were on movie soundtracks that I've heard before. So I never would have sought this out. I never would have gave it a chance. And that's what's great about people recommending stuff like this to us. It gives us the opportunity to find new music and share our thoughts on it with you guys, because we're always right. And you know, it's Hillbilly Beach Boys.
Yeah, and so do feel free to offer recommendations for us to do, and we're open to multiple paths on that if you would actually like to join us for the review, we're very cool with that. If you would like to hear the review and provide a rebuttal, we're very cool with that as well. But we'd love to hear what you've got to say. Please, for the love of God, don't recommend a Beach Boys album. That's all I ask.
So not only should you recommend a Beach Boys album, I think we should put it out there to all of our listeners, since obviously we're going to record Ruby Ridge the musical. We're going to put together a track that's going to have a huge chorus to it, and listeners should be able to submit their voice to be included on the giant chorus for Ruby Ridge the musical.
Yeah, so we'll be getting you those lyrics shortly since we wrote about half of it tonight. So we'll see how it goes. And I think while we should have stopped a while ago, I think we will stop now. And I'd like to thank Mel again very much for the recommendation, and thank you all for listening.
Thanks, guys, and thank you, Mel.
Hey, everybody. It's Mel from Nurture and Support. I am recording my rebuttal, I suppose, for Kelly and Mike's review of my prisoner exchange recommendation to them of Mighty Joe Moon by Grantley Buffalo. I don't have the list that I had given them to choose from in front of me, but I really think that of everything on that list, this album was probably the odd man out from musical style. And so I was really kind of surprised when Kelly told me this was the album that they were going to do. I was a little worried. I was honestly a little worried that they were going to rip this album apart. So I'm happy that they didn't hate it. I'm not sure how much they loved it. This happens to be one of my favorite albums. I told them that there were a few albums on that list that were, for lack of a better term, sacred to me, and I would get really, really upset if they ripped them apart. So they didn't rip this one apart, at least we can say that. This album came out in 1994, and just to clarify, it is alternative. It is not country grunge. But just a moment, let me consult my notes. It's not Hillbilly Grace or Hillbilly Celtic or Hillbilly Emo, which I can't say that any of those terms are not applicable, but technically this is alternative. Alternative in 1994. So some of you listening may not have been alive in 1994. So I do appreciate you listening this far, because this is unlike, I think, anything else they've really talked about on Squat Cobbler. So hopefully you'll give this album a try. It is lyrically one of my favorite albums. There's a lot of really good lyrics going on in this album. So I'm glad that they didn't hate it. I hope some of you give it a listen and don't hate it too. Though I have to say, Mike, I'm really deeply, deeply offended by the Achy Breaky Heart reference. Like, deeply offended. Really, really offended. How dare you bring Achy Breaky Heart anywhere close to this album? So to go ahead and jump to the questions Mike wanted answered at the end of their discussion. I really don't know much about Ruby Ridge, so I don't feel qualified to title a song about anything that happened there, because I really don't know very much about it. And again, for the Beach Boys song, what song on this album is most like a Beach Boys song? I really have no idea. I would recognize probably a Beach Boys song if I heard it, but I couldn't name one for you right now because I didn't listen to the Beach Boys. I did watch a lot of Gidget when I was a kid, and for some reason the two of those go together. I don't know if it's merely the beach involved, but I really couldn't tell you anything about the Beach Boys whatsoever, so I apologize for that. Now, which of the lyrics on this album would I get a tattoo of? That is a really, really hard question, because this album is full of outstanding lyrics. So I'm gonna have to think really hard about that. So it's really hard to choose, but one of my favorite songs on the album is Demon Called Deception. And the opening lines of that song are, I'm in tight with a demon called Deception. It's all right. He's treating me quite well. That may be my tattoo from this album. I don't know. There's so many good ones, but a lot of my favorite lyrics are quite long from this album. So lyrically, this is a great album. It's a combination of cultural references, historical references, and literary references. So it's all good in Mel's book. So I'm glad you guys didn't hate it. Grantley Buffalo only put out 3 albums. The front man for the group was Grantley Phillips. He has several more albums of a slightly different nature than this particular album. This is still continues to be one of my favorite albums he ever did. So that's, I guess, all I have to say on the matter. Mighty Joe Moon by Grantley Buffalo is one of my favorite albums, so thank you, Mike and Kelly, for not totally destroying it, because then I would have to unfriend you everywhere and never speak to you again. So I will try to get over my offense at the hillbilly references, though. That was a little much, but we'll work through it together.
Yeah, so it's...